Penguin Random House Audio presents Permission to Rest, Revolutionary Practices for Healing, Empowerment, and Collective Care. This is the author, Ashley Neese. To the courage it takes to choose this book and do this work. To the grief that goes hand in hand with slowing down. To the revolution that is rest, may we honor its powers to restore, to repair, and to reclaim the parts of ourselves that we have hidden, betrayed, or numbed in our efforts to avoid the medicine we need. To the holiness that is available through cultivating rest practices, giving ourselves our birthright. To rest itself, providing the space to vision a future that cares for the planet and the whole. Part 1, In Praise of Rest. Resting is one of the most impactful practices we can adopt for self-compassion, emotional well-being, collective care, and environmental repair. When we take a few moments each day to pause, to feel our exhales, to listen to the sounds that are present, or to notice the way light bends around a corner, we are engaging in a subversive act of reclaiming the innate wisdom within our bodies and within the natural world, the wisdom of rest. When we practice resting, we allow ourselves to follow an organic rhythm that has the power to heal, to restore, and to liberate us from the oppression of overwork and constant productivity of our culture. When we practice resting, we engage in revolutionary acts that create social and environmental changes, rippling out to shift all aspects of life. Yet most of us will say, on any given day, that we simply cannot take the time to rest. I get it. I've been there. I've been on the burnout train more times than I care to admit. I've struggled with addiction to substances, to work, to being of service, and to social media. I've pushed myself to the point of being bedridden more than once. I've fallen into the trap of believing that if I just do more, help more, work more, and keep pushing past my limits, I will finally feel like I am enough. And then I will be able to relax. I've avoided rest for many of the reasons you've probably avoided it too. It's inconvenient and uncomfortable. Yet after years of dodging the medicine I needed the most, I'm here to tell you, there is no substitute for rest. There is no way to escape our fundamental human need for renewal. Individually and as a culture, we have been failing to take care of this essential need. And it's causing high levels of stress and depletion within ourselves, our communities, and our environment. We are exhausted. We are overwhelmed. We are weary. Our bodies need rest. Our minds need rest. Our hearts need rest. Our relationships need rest. Our creativity needs rest. Our culture needs rest. Our earth needs rest. The promising news is that the value of rest is gradually on the rise in our collective consciousness. Enough of us are recognizing that feeling depleted and perpetually exhausted doesn't have to be our baseline. Enough of us are tired of being sick and tired and are choosing to rest despite existing in a culture that tells us to rest is to admit weakness and needing to slow down is something that we should be ashamed of. It's okay to slow down. It's okay to pause. It's okay to rest. My journey to rest. If you are new to my work, I am a trauma-informed breathwork teacher and author of How to Breathe, 25 Simple Practices for Calm, Joy, and Resilience. I work with clients individually and facilitate group work through retreats and trainings. Even though I have devoted much of my life to healing and service work, I didn't come to rest with ease. I came to the practice of rest like I showed up to my first 12-step meeting, broken down, disconnected, and completely out of options. And just as I surrendered in my early 12-step days to the truth of my addictions and how far I would go to avoid the pain I carried, learning how to rest involved a surrender. When I first started questioning the pace of my life, I had been in recovery groups and therapy for more than a decade and had a strong yoga and breathing practice. And my life still wasn't working. Something was missing, making it impossible for me to settle for extended periods of time. My body asked me in many ways to slow down, to take a break, to feel, and I was not listening. I felt I had no real value unless I kept myself busy, calm-seeming, looking like I had it figured out and could do life all by myself. Eventually, I experienced a series of emotional and physical breakdowns while sober. I hit one wall, then another, until I finally hit bottom and could not go on. Heeding the advice of my 12-step sponsor, I put myself on a plane back to my hometown of Atlanta, Georgia, where I spent 5 weeks at my mother's house, slowing down, resting, and allowing her to show up for me. During my time there, I napped almost every day. I took walks with my mother around the lake by her house. We cooked nearly every meal together. I stopped going on social media. I took a break from my friend group. I went to yoga classes. I started to breathe a little deeper. I took care of myself and allowed my mother to support me. For years, I muscled my way through life, believing it was superior, even noble, to take care of myself without the support of others. I unconsciously participated in some of the most damaging illusions that are woven into the fabric of our culture. The false idea that we are separate, that our individual needs are more important than the needs of the whole. When I began my journey to rest, I became aware that self-reliance was depleting me many times over, and that despite my best efforts to uphold the individualist framework in my life, I was never truly on my own. I was, in fact, interdependent. Becoming aware of that interconnection gave me the necessary support to rest, to regroup, to recalibrate, and to feel the beating of my own heart and envision a future I wanted to be a part of. After years of being on the run and feeling alone, I was finally willing to press pause on my life and spend focused time cultivating a relationship with the medicine that I desperately needed, the medicine of rest. Going back to my hometown in Georgia was a turning point. I surrendered to the cries of my body and made a commitment to stop avoiding what I was terrified to face if I slowed down long enough to rest, myself. It turned out that learning to rest in our dominant culture of always-on busyness and grind until you burn out was much more of a challenge than getting sober. Resting was something that was much more elusive to me. I didn't know I needed it or that I was allowed to do it, let alone cultivate it into a healing practice. Returning to Georgia was one of the best decisions I ever made for my mental, physical, emotional, and spiritual health. It sent me on a path of uncovering why I kept pushing myself into periods of burnout. This led me to untangle and start healing the trauma I had inherited and experienced in my life. This journey proved to me that even though I struggled with believing in myself and trusting myself and my body, I was worth taking care of. I was worth feeling rested. Why rest? My experience with rest has been anything but linear, anything but smooth. I've had to learn through fits and starts that rest isn't just an activity you do occasionally when you're exhausted. Rest is a practice, and practices require consistency, dedication, and a willingness to show up, even when you're too busy. Especially when you're too busy. Resting for a little while here and there isn't enough to create meaningful, sustainable changes. Although you will likely feel a shift after just a few moments of resting, Rest is a cumulative practice.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.